What I want you to think about when we get started is what should be the goal of economic policy? What's the goal? Suppose you're in charge. Now, nobody's actually in charge. You find that out, I think, very quickly when you get into government. We were talking last night. Someone said, so-and-so, a particular person in the government, until he got in the government, he was so smart. Then he gets to the government, he starts saying stupid things. How does that happen? And I think we have an idea of how that happens, right? Incentives, things that encourage one thing or another, are different when you're here with, what's the cost to me of saying something stupid? Well, Bob might not invite me back, right? If I'm in the government, if I say something that hurts my party, hurts my prime minister, I might lose my job. Even if it's smart, I might lose my job. So people in government say things differently when they're in government than before they're in government. But pretend you are in government, and you don't care. You just want to do the right thing. What would you think about? How would you decide what your goal should be? How would you decide how you would achieve that goal? What would you need to know to achieve that goal? Very hard questions. That's what I want you to start thinking about in this first session that I'm going to be talking about today. So one answer might be, our job, if we're, quote, I'm going to put this in quotation marks, running the economy. You understand that expression, to run the economy? Meaning to steer it over here, over there. Now, in fact, nobody runs the economy. Not even, who's the head of the central bank here? Yaron, what's his last name?
That's his last name.
Yaron. Mr. Yaron doesn't run the economy. He probably doesn't even run the central bank. He just, do you think, by the way, I apologize, I have to leave in the middle of Omer's talk this morning. Why? I have to run the college. Shalem. Do I really run the college? You think I'm there all day deciding what's going to happen, calling people, don't do that, do this, do that, do this. I'm not running the college, right? Nobody runs the college. Nobody runs the Central Bank of Israel. Nobody runs the economy. But we do influence the economy, right? So if you were in charge and you could do whatever you wanted, what should be your goal? Come, give me a couple answers. What should be your goal? Anybody? Raise your hand. Yeah.
Make as much money as you can.
Make as much money as you can. Is that a good goal? Is that your goal in life?
No.
Mine either. Right? Why not?
Because I have other values.
You have other values, right? What other values do you have? Honesty, right? Yeah. You wouldn't want to do something. Some people would. Some people would say, I don't care whether it's honest or ethical. I'm just going to make as much money as possible. I would say that's a very bad life, right? And I think people mistakenly believe that economics is about making money. Economics is not about making money. Economics is about making choices and considering the costs of your choices. What do you give up? How many people here are economics majors? Raise your hand. So in economics, the fancy word is we say opportunity cost. What opportunity do you give up? The opportunity cost for me this morning is doing something else, right? Maybe answering some emails, writing an essay, working on a book, spending time with my wife, who's kindly here. I don't know why. It's a lovely gesture, though, isn't it? She knows everything I'm going to say. She's heard it 1,000 times. But it's always good when you give a talk that there's someone near the front of the room going, because it makes you feel better. Because it's scary being up here. I haven't been up here in about a year and a half. So I'm having fun, though, so far. It's early. So what economics is about making choices and remembering what you lose. So if your goal in life is to make money, what do you lose?
Time.
To do what?
Be happy.
Be happy, maybe. Some people like to. I love my job, by the way. I've always loved my job. I love using my skills, usually, I hope, in the right way. But what else? What else might you lose if you spend too much time at work?
Family.
Self-development, reading, leisure, knowledge, all these things that also are of value. And life is about choosing between those trade-offs. So should the goal of the government be to have the people be as rich as possible?
No.
I don't think so. It's not a bad goal, but it's not the only thing we care about. For sure, it is not the only thing we care about. So I want you to think about how does that affect, by the way? You'll often hear the phrase, I don't know how often you hear it here in Israel, but in America, a common phrase that people use is that economic policy should serve what? Fill in the blank. Serve the people. It should do what's good for the people. Is that a good idea? Is that better or worse than what I said before? What's good or bad about that idea? What's good about it?
It's too general.
It's what?
It's too general.
It's too general. Why?
Because
I said what's good about it, but he's going to say what's bad about it. I don't blame you. It's bad. It's a lovely idea. It's like saying, it's not like saying, I was going to say, my goal in my marriage is to be a good husband. That's a pretty good goal, right? That's a pretty good goal. But why is that different than to do something that's good for the people? Yeah.
They don't want it.
But then I shouldn't do that. I should do things they want, right?
People are different.
People are different. Why does that matter?
Because when you say you want to be a good husband, you say it about yourself. You have measurements that are relevant for you anyway.
Well, I should take account of my wife, right? When I think about what makes a good husband, I should think about her also. If I'm in charge of the economy and I say, I did that. Why did you do this policy? Because it's good for the people. What policy can you think of? Can you think of any policy that is good for the people? I'm just going to pick three to think about. Is it good that you cannot get an Uber in Israel? That you have to use Get, right? How many people use Get? Raise your hand. So I use it. It's very awkward. I say to my wife, I'm going to go get a Get, which it says I'm going to get a divorce. It's not nice. So now I say I'm going to get a Get ride to make it clear. So is it good for the people that Uber is not legal in Israel? How many people have ever taken an Uber outside of Israel? Raise your hand. Horrible, isn't it? It's terrible. The car is dirty. They never have any water for you to drink. They don't have a charger for you. Actually, they have all those things. When I take an Uber, they ask me, do you want some water? Do you want a charger for your phone? Does that ever happen to you? Has it ever happened to you at a Get?
No.
Why? What's the difference?
No competition.
No incentive. Less. I wouldn't say no incentive. Less incentive. Less incentive in the Get, right? So is the ban on Uber good for the people of Israel or bad? How many people think it's good? How many think it's bad? It's good for some people. Who are they? The cab drivers. It's good for them. Now, should they have the privilege? Some cab drivers, not all of them. It's good for the cab drivers who already drive a cab. What'd you say?
The cab owners.
Much better for them.
License.
Correct. Much better for them than probably the drivers, but it's probably good for the drivers too, relative to Uber, maybe. But of course, are there more jobs driving a car in Israel in the current world, or would there be more jobs driving a car if Uber were legal? More if Uber were legal, because why? It would be cheaper, and therefore, what would happen? More people would want to take rides from other people instead of walking or driving their own car, and therefore, there would be more jobs. Is that a good thing? Is that good for the people? Well, it's going to be fewer jobs somewhere else, right? If people are spending more money on Uber, and there are more jobs in Uber, there's probably fewer jobs somewhere else in the economy. So who should decide the number of jobs of each kind? Right now, the government has a policy that says, we don't want more than this number. That is good for the owners of the cabs. It's good, I think, for the cab drivers who are able to drive a cab, maybe. Who's it bad for? Everyone else. But it would be foolish to say Uber, the ban on Uber is bad for the people of Israel. I'd say it's good for most people. Should we decide, by the way, how should we decide then? So we have the cab drivers and cab owners get a benefit. The people who like to draw, to move around get a loss. How should we weigh those things? We could count the number of people. What's that like? How would you do that? You could have a vote. In democracy, in politics, each person gets one vote, period. Some places you get more than one. But in most places, you're only supposed to get one. So that's one way to count the fact that some people benefit and some people gain. If we did a vote whether Uber should be allowed, what would the answer be? I think it would win a referendum. In English, we would say a referendum, meaning a survey or a poll or a vote. So should we do it then? Should that be the decision maker? How many people think that should be the decision maker? The number of people who benefit versus the number of people who lose. It's hard to say. It counts. It's relevant. It's not the only thing that's relevant. If I could make a lot of people really rich by killing some people, should I do it? Probably not. Not a good idea. Should I make a lot of people a dollar richer if I make a small group of people very, very poor? That makes people uneasy, right? But the first thing I want you to realize is that when you think about what the goal of an economic policy should be, it's much more complicated than you usually hear about it in the news and in the world. Because usually some people gain, some people lose, and now you have to decide, should it be the number of people, the amount of dollars in total, right? A lot of people would defend a utilitarian approach. In a utilitarian approach, which sounds good, you'd say, can somebody describe what utilitarianism would say? There's one phrase for utilitarianism. How would you describe it? In English, it's the greatest good for the greatest number of people. Well, who could be against that? Well, I am. I don't think it's a very useful, I think it's a dangerous rule. But most economists would say, most economists use a variant, to use a word that doesn't sound good in 2021, a variant, a version of that rule. So let me take one more example. Food is very expensive in Israel, right? We had protests about it here. I can say we now, because I'm an Ezrach. We had protests about it, 10 years ago? We were talking about it last night. Why is food so expensive? I think the average person thinks that food is expensive because the people who make the food are greedy. They try to make too much money. They should be nicer. Is that a good way to think about the price of food? I don't think so. I think the price of food is high because Israel keeps out food from outside of Israel and reduces competition within Israel. And that allows the owners of food and land and farmers to charge higher prices. Is that good for the country? It's bad for the people who eat food. It's good for who? The farmers and the landowners, right? Is that fair? Is that right? I think we would maybe have different opinions of that. But that's the standard way an economist tends to think about these discussions. Some people win, some people lose. The number of people who win or lose might be very, very different. I just gave you two examples, Uber and food restrictions on imports, where the number of people who gain are very small and the number of people who lose are very large. But the people who lose only lose a little bit, and the people who gain, gain a lot. And guess what they want to do? Protect it, right? They spend a lot of time and energy making sure that those restrictions stay in place for them. These people, me and you, the eaters of eggs and honey, right, and chicken, we pay a little more for food. We're not going to devote our life, unless you're crazy like me, you're not going to devote your life to fighting restrictions on trade. So that's sometimes how the world works. I would argue that the goal of life, not just economic policy, the goal of life is to live fully, to use your gifts, to give what either, if you're a believer in God, what God has given you, if you don't believe in God, what nature has given you, your genetic endowment, your effort, what you've done to transform yourself. To me, the goal of life and the goal of good economic policy should be the same. To allow people, in English, we would say, to flourish. Le sigsag, is that how you say it? Le sigsag, yes? Sagseg, le sagseg. Le sagseg, to flourish, to blossom like a flower, to grow, to choose your own path. Very important. We live in a time, just unbelievable gift. You don't have to do what your parents do. Through most of human history, you had to do the same job your parents did, by the way. You know what that job was through most of human history? Farming. Farming is a very hard life. Today, it can be a very hard life. Now, in a modern era, it's not as hard as it was in 1900. Elif Chemeot, okay? 1900 was a much harder life. Farming was smaller, was more dangerous, very dangerous, right? And very difficult. You had to get up very early. There was things that were satisfying about it, I think. To grow food is a beautiful thing, right? But you don't have to be a farmer. Whatever your parents do, some of your parents might be a lawyer, a doctor, a teacher. You can choose that, but you don't have to. Think about for a minute what your life would be like if I said you have to do what your parents do. How many people think they will end up doing the same job as one of their parents? Raise your hand. Great, two people. The rest of you would like to do something different. And the world is alive in an open economy, in an economy of freedom. You have choices. You can choose what to do. Is that true for everyone? Right? You're very unusual, right? You're in a first-rate university. Okay, second-rate. You're not at Shalem, but you're at a very good school. That's a joke for the video. You're at a very good school, right? You have two great gifts. Economist I used to work with, his name was Walter Roy. He said the two most important choices you make in life are your spouse, the person you marry, and your parents. Now, of course, you don't choose your parents. It's a joke. He meant what your parents give you is what often determines a lot of what you're going to be able to be. What do they give you? Genetics, right? They have a certain raw material, certain set of skills and abilities. They also give you something else, though. They might have encouraged you to work hard, to do things that were unpleasant, even though they weren't fun, but you kept doing them, right? That's what your parents give you. And you, almost certainly every one of you and me and our children have been given great gifts. Not everybody gets those gifts. They can't go to college. Either they can't afford it or they don't have the skills. So when I say I have a very romantic, I don't know if that word works in Hebrew, but Ivrit, but in English, romantic doesn't just mean love between two people. It means like, what?
Like being passionate about something.
Being passionate and more than passionate, I would say, to use another word that's confusing, but I'm going to use it anyway, seduced. To be attracted and drawn to something. For some people, by the way, that's farming. There's a lot of romance around farming. It's beautiful. You work the land. You make the desert bloom. Of course, when you're out and it's 120 degrees in the Fahrenheit in the Negev, it's not so romantic, right? When the tractor turns over and crushes your leg, it's not so romantic, right? It's a little more realistic. But we have a beautiful idea from movies and books about the romance of farming. But my point is that I just gave you a very romantic picture of economic freedom that applies, I think, to every person in this room. But it doesn't apply to every person within 10 miles of here. So one of the things that I hope you are thinking about is, but what about the people who don't have the gifts? What about the people who don't have the skills? What about the people who don't grow up in a home like mine? What does economic freedom do for them? Good question, right? Good question. Where's their flourishing? Where's their segseg? Where's their chance to use their gifts? So on Wednesday, when I come back, is it Wednesday? I think it's Wednesday when I come back. I'm going to talk about that, okay? So let's just put that to the side for the moment. It's a very important question. So I believe deeply that the purpose of life and the purpose of an economic policy is not to make as much money as possible. It's to allow us to flourish, to allow us to express ourselves through the life we live, to give us choices. So I'm going to, I don't know if Bob agrees with me, but I like economic freedom because of what it does to the quality of life, not the quantity of money. Now, money counts. If you're really hungry all the time, it's very hard to enjoy poetry. It's very hard to flourish. So it, Ramat HaChaim, is that correct? Standard of living is not unimportant. It's important, but it's not the only thing that's important. And so when I think about why I care about economic freedom, it's not just because it creates wealth. I think it creates opportunity for us, for self, what in English we say agency, responsibility, a chance to express our gifts, to use our gifts. Okay, that's the first point. So the first point is what economic policy should be about isn't simple. There's no such thing as, oh, that's good for the country. You may think it's, quote, good for the country overall, or more or less, but it's usually complicated. And that is why one of the most, the deepest lessons of economics is no solutions, only trade-offs. No solutions. People say, well, let's fix that. Usually fixing that means making something else broken in economics. There's a, that's not always true of government action, right? Government, the most important thing government does is keep us safe, right? That's a really good use of government. And that, in theory, should be unanimous. Everybody should like that. That is good for the people. But economic, that's foreign policy, but economic policy is usually more complicated. So you have to think about what should I consider and how should I accept or deal with trade-offs. Okay. Now, in general, I believe that this conference, this experience here, is about a very deep question that is not obvious as the question to think about. Here's my question. What happens when you leave things alone? What happens when you leave things alone? Very hard to do. To leave things alone. I have a very simple, I said I have a very simple message. Not so simple, because I just gave you, if it was really simple, it'd be one thing, but I just gave you one thing, right? The first thing I tried to teach is that we're different. Policies affect us differently, and therefore economic policy is complicated, but it probably isn't simply to make as much money as possible. It probably has something to say about the human experience. Okay? So that was the first thing. The second thing, and this is what I'm going to talk about the rest of the time, and it's related to the first thing. The second thing is, when you leave things alone, what happens is not obvious in the economy. In your life, it's very obvious. So you eat dinner, you get a bunch of dishes, you put them in the sink, and you walk away. Did they clean themselves? No. If you leave them alone, what happens? It's disgusting, right? It gets worse. It's a very bad idea. If you want to go to medical school, if you want to go to college, and you decide, just going to play video games all day. What happens? You don't do very well. You might have one friend who is so smart they can still get to college and do well. But for most of us, you can't just say, my career will take care of itself. You have to be proactive. You have to do things. You can't leave things alone. The economy is different. That's my simple lesson for the rest of my time. A lot of times, not always, I'm going to give you some exceptions, but a lot of times in the economy, leaving things alone works better than you think. And fixing things is worse than you think. It doesn't mean leave everything alone. That would be foolish. It doesn't mean fix everything all the time. That would be foolish. But usually your intuition, everyday people, their intuition of what is going to work and not work well is surprising when you learn about what happens when you leave things alone. Take a couple examples. First, I'm going to talk about good intentions. Okay? Good intentions. How would you say that be Ivrit? Good intentions. Kavanot tovot. Kavanot tovot. So kavanot tovot in our everyday life. Do you like to be around people with kavanot tovot or kavanot raot? Tovot, Ken. Right, you don't want to be around people who say, you know, I don't really like you. I'm going to steal some of your stuff, but it'll work out for the best. No, that's horrible, right? You want people who care about you. Now, of course, sometimes, even though we care about people, sometimes what? Doesn't always turn out well. We make mistakes as parents, as children, as husbands, wives. We make mistakes. But in everyday life, kavanot tovot is fantastic. You have to have it. It's why how we choose our friends. It's how we choose our spouse. Kavanot tovot. But in economic policy, more complicated. So I'm going to give you a couple examples. My favorite, one of my favorites, 1958. 1958 Ushmona. Ushmona?
Yeah.
Do people say both?
Yeah.
Yeah, because they don't know their own language. Can you believe it? In America, everybody speaks perfect English. It's terrible, right? Okay, so in 1958, in China, Mao, who was in charge, in some sense, of the Chinese economy, he had what he called the four pests campaign. A pest is something you don't like, right? A pest is mosquitoes, rats, right? So one of the things he didn't like was the sparrow. A sparrow is a little bird, Sipur Katan, Ken, that's, you know what a sparrow, right? You know what it looks like? It's about this big. They had a lot of sparrows in China. So they decided to kill as many as possible. There are videos of Chinese people with brooms going up to trees and hitting the trees so that the nests will fall out, the birds will go crazy. They're shooting birds. There's truckloads, literally truckloads of dead birds being collected because they're going to get rid of the sparrow. And why do they want to get rid of the sparrow? Because the sparrow eats grain. And the grain crop, the oats or the corn, whatever it was, the wheat, there wasn't enough. And so if we get rid of the sparrows, what's going to happen? We'll have what? More grain or less grain?
More grain.
If there are fewer sparrows, by definition, there's going to be more grain. Because why? Simple. What's the explanation? Sparrows eat grain. Now, just something to think about. One of my favorite birds in the world is the bald eagle. You know what an eagle? Nesher. Ken?
What?
I?
The name
I.
Is I.
No, it's not Nesher, it's I.
I. Okay. It's a beautiful bird. There aren't very many of them, right? If we want more of them, should we eat them or not eat them?
Not eat them.
Not eat them! In fact, in America, against the law to kill an eagle. So if we want there to be more chickens or fewer chickens, oof, should we eat them or not eat them?
Should eat them.
Eat them. How many chickens are there in the world? In America, I don't know the numbers for Israel, but in America, there are about a billion chickens right now, alive in America, a billion. They have no chance of going out of existence. Why? Raise your hand. Why? Why are there so many chickens in America? People eat them, but there should be fewer if people eat them.
We control.
What, why is that not true?
We control the birth of chickens.
We what?
We control the birth.
We control the birth. Why? Who would do such a stupid thing? Aren't there people controlling the birth of eagles too? There are.
The free market.
But why? What's that? What's the mechanism? How does that work?
Incentives.
What's the incentive?
People buy it.
People buy it, and therefore, people can make a profit taking care of them. Now they don't take care of them that well because they do kill them to eat. So we have. I'm not saying that it's better that we should all eat eagles, because if we ate eagles, what would happen? There would be a lot more eagles. But they wouldn't really be eagles. They would be more like chickens, right? They'd be in a controlled environment. So I'm not suggesting that we should eat eagles, but what I want you to see is that your natural intuition, your natural way of thinking, doesn't work in this environment. One more, I just have to tell you this. I have more than one, I don't know, it's hard. Okay, I have a friend. She has a veterinarian, a person who takes care of animals. Her veterinarian says, if you bring me a cat, a chatul, I will vaccinate it for free, okay? And you'll take care of it. And she said, and that way, there's one less cat on the streets of Yerushalayim. True or false? Not so easy question to answer. Quite complicated when you start to think about it. And when you start to think about it that way, you have to be careful, because if you're not careful, you might start using more paper towels. If you use more paper towels, do you get more trees or fewer trees?
More trees.
You get more trees if you use paper towels. So when it says use this thing that dries your hands with the hot air, with all the germs that are around there, and blows them onto your hands, and they pretend it's good for you. I always like that. It's not obvious that it's good for the environment. By the way, it uses electricity too, by the way. So it's kind of complicated. So your intuition, your natural way of thinking. So poor Mao, the head of Sin, who thought, I'm going to get rid of sparrows and I'll get more grain, got less grain. Why? Because the sparrows didn't just eat grain, they ate locusts. Arbe. And when they killed all the sparrows, there was an enormous explosion of the number of locusts, and the grain got eaten by the locusts, and they had a serious food problem. So sometimes the connections between things that have good intentions, kavanot tovot, are not so good. Should we have a minimum wage? Should we have a salary that has to reach a certain level if you're going to hire someone as a worker? Who's that good for? Who benefits if we have what is the minimum wage in Israel? I assume there's one. Sorry, how much is it? 5,300 shekels
for a month.
Okay. Is that good or bad? Who's it good for? So people who are making let's make it easy. Let's make it 10,000 instead of 5,300. So you're saying if we make it 10,000, that'll be good for the people who are currently making 5,300. Is that true?
No.
Maybe. The ones who keep their jobs, it's definitely better. But you might not keep your job. Why not?
Well, what's so cheaper?
We've made it more expensive to hire someone.
Yeah.
Who are we talking about? The people with a lot of skill or people with less skill? Less skill. It seems to me a cruel thing to do. Now, economists debate right now a lot about how big that effect is. And you might want to take that into account. If it's only a few people, I can't say it. I was going to say, well, if it's only a few people, I mean, if you only ruin a few people's lives, it's a horrible thing, right? It's a very utilitarian thing to say. If it's only a few people, and if so many people get double what they earned before, then it's a good policy. I'm a little uncomfortable with that. I would prefer an alternative way to help the people making $5,300 rather than to harm some of the people who are, have a hard time already. There's a short, anybody here read Ursula Le Guin, short science fiction writer? One, two, anybody else? She wrote a story. I don't know if it's translated into Hebrew. You can find it online. It's one of the best stories you'll ever read. It's 5 pages long. It's called The Ones Who Walk Away from Omelus. Will you share it with the group?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So read that story. It'll make you think. It's a very powerful story. But my point is that is the minimum wage good for Israel? It's good for some people in Israel. Whether it's good or bad, I think it's bad, but it's not easy to explain why. And it's certainly true that if you leave things alone, so the first point I got off on a tangent there. I'm trying to say, if you intervene, If you try to control things, sometimes things happen you don't anticipate. In economics, we call that the law of unintended consequences, right? Unintended. E-Kavanot? Is that? Yeah? Okay. Now I want to close, and then I'll take questions. I want to tell you a story about what happens when you leave things alone. So I told you a story there about what happens when you intervene, even with good intentions. Sometimes you get a surprise. Now I want to talk about what happens when you leave things alone. So, the United States, once a year, has a football game, American football, which is not real football. American football, called the Super Bowl. Have you heard of it?
Yeah.
Okay. You ever watch it?
No.
But it, what?
The
commercials are very entertaining, right? Why are the commercials so good? Because of the incentives, because a lot of people are watching and they have a chance, they're very expensive. So you want to make a really good commercial to have an impact, right? Okay. So on Super Bowl in America, probably here too, but mainly in America because of the time difference, many, many Americans throw a party. Okay? They throw a party. The most popular things they serve at the party, you want to guess what people eat at Super Bowl parties in America? What do they eat?
Hot dogs.
Chicken wings.
Chicken wings, hot dogs, one more.
Pizza.
Pizza. So it turns out, on Super Bowl Sunday, there's 12 million pizzas sold in the United States. 12 million pizzas. It's a lot of pizza. That's 35% more than on the average day. Now, by the way, if you were taking notes, you would write that down, 35% more. It's not a real, what we would call a data point. It's not really an... It's kind of a made-up number. It's a guess. They don't really know exactly how much pizza, but if I had said 35.7% more, you'd say, oh, wow, 35.7. Must be really a serious, they must really work hard to get that number. But anyway, it's more. It's a lot more on Super Bowl Sunday. And there's a lot more chicken wings sold. I used to know that number. It's a frightening number if you like chickens. A lot of chickens without wings, kind of sad. But here's the interesting thing about it. Here's the interesting thing. There are people in America who don't like football. There are people in America who don't watch the Super Bowl. And there are people in America who don't like pizza. Okay, three. But there are a few people, right? Okay, does anybody not like pizza? I mean, does anybody... It's a crazy thing how attractively delicious a piece of pizza is. I mean, if it didn't have calories, and someone, you're just walking down the street, and I said, hey, you want one now? Oh, of course. Who wouldn't want one? It's almost impossible to say no to. And a second, and a third. But anyway, so on Super Bowl Sunday, there are people who don't watch the game, don't eat pizza, don't eat chicken wings, some people don't even know the game is being played, okay? And I want you to imagine this person. So this person decides to invite some friends over, not for a Super Bowl party, but for a pasta party. Spaghetti. Goes to the store. Can you buy spaghetti on Super Bowl Sunday? Can you buy a bagel on Super Bowl Sunday? Of course you can. You can have anything you want. You go into any grocery in America on Super Bowl Sunday, the week before Super Bowl Sunday, the week after Super Bowl Sunday, the shelves are full of spaghetti and bagels and rye bread and other types of products. But what could have happened, it's not ridiculous. There's so much wheat that gets made into flour, that gets made into pizza crust. Isn't it possible that you would go in and say, I'll have a dozen bagels, please. I'm throwing a brunch for some friends of mine. Bagels? Don't you know it's Super Bowl Sunday? We got all the wheat went to the pizzas. We don't have any left for bagels. Spaghetti? Are you crazy? Don't you know? Never happens. You want to go buy a pencil? Anybody here using a pencil? It's an old-fashioned thing. Iparon. Anybody have one? Well, can you get one in Israel? You can. You can still buy them whenever you want. In America, they're everywhere. But for a long time, one of the greatest changes in human history took place that you didn't notice. When you were younger, when you were 6 years old, right? You were 6 years old and you went to school and they gave you a pencil and your parents bought you a pencil. You didn't think about the fact that that was a miracle. Why would it be a miracle that you could buy a pencil? Because around that time, do you know how many Chinese left the farm and went to the city? Do you know the numbers? In the 1990s, I think, is that the right time? When the biggest migration took place, 80s, 90s, and 2000, for a few decades, about 300, maybe more, 300 million Chinese people decided to leave their farm and go live in the city. And those kids of those people, instead of working on the farm, what did they do? They went to school. And when they went to school, what did they need? A pencil. So there were 300 million pencils or more that had to get shipped to China or grown in China. And there should have been no pencils for the rest of us. When you went to the store, when your parents went to the store, oh, a dozen pencils, please. Are you kidding? All the pencils went to China this year. Don't you know what's going on? Oh, I guess I should have what? I should have called the minister of pencils, Sarah Iparon, and said, I have a kid and a lot of my friends have kids. So you make sure there's pencils in Israel? Because I understand the Chinese, when I want bagels, on Super Bowl Sunday, do I have to call the minister of bread and say, I just want you to know, I don't like it that there's all this pizza being made on Super Bowl Sunday because some of us don't like football. And we want to make sure I'm going to protest to make sure there's a, you don't have to do that. Why not? Why is it that so many things like that, they're all happening in the background. You don't have to do anything. They're just left alone. You don't need a minister of bread. You don't need a minister of pencils. That's quite extraordinary. So I'm not going to say that everything in the world works like bread and pencils, because it doesn't. Housing could, maybe, if we gave it a chance. We don't give it a chance here. It needs to be, I think, a little more free. to create housing for people who are both rich and poor in Tel Aviv and Yerushalayim and elsewhere. But it doesn't work everywhere, because what's driving that process? Why is it that there's plenty of pizza and spaghetti? Why is it that there's pencils in China and in Israel? What's underlying that? And the answer is two things. You want to think about what those two things are? Just think for a minute. What are the two things that push and create and allow, even though no one's in charge, no one's running the pencil market, no one's running the bread market, the flour market, the wheat market. The two things are competition and prices. And to me, the study of economics, which is our topic in these few days, is to understand when that works and when it doesn't. It works much better than you'd think it would if I just told you about it. Greedy people, not necessarily greedy, but people who are self-interested, they're not the same thing. People who are looking out for themselves, because of competition, have to do a good job making bread for other people. Why does the baker get up at 4 a.m? Not because he loves you. The baker wants you to have fresh bread. Why does she get up at 4 a.m? Because she's afraid that the other bakers will get up at 4 a.m. and that her bread will not be as fresh. And she works to serve you. Omar and I were talking last night. Suppose I said to you, you have to get to the airport by 6 o'clock tonight. And waiting for you there is $1 million. When would you leave? But if you don't get there by 6 o'clock, you don't get the $1 million. When would you leave? Now, yesterday, an hour ago, you wouldn't be here, right? If you wanted to make sure you got there, would you rely on your cousin or somebody who's out to make a profit? That's a tricky question. Of course, the answer would be what? Depends what kind of cousin you have. But in general, I don't have to worry about whether the Uber driver, if I have Uber, is going to show up. That's an amazing thing. It's not unimportant. It's quite extraordinary. So a lot to me of what economics is about is understanding when is competition and prices sufficient to create the choices of life, and when is it not sufficient. So an obvious example of when it's not sufficient is pollution. If I can dump my garbage, my poisonous air, my garbage in your lake, your stream, your river, I might do that because it's cheaper for me than taking care of it and throwing it out. I don't want to leave that incentive alone. I want some kind of regulation or legal restriction on my ability to harm you that way. So the question for economic policy is, who said last night where you draw the line? About red lines. Where do you draw the line? So I tend to draw it. I don't think we should have anarchy. What is it?
Anarchia.
Not so good. But whenever you look at an outcome of economic freedom and you don't like it, you always have to ask yourself, what's better? Is there a better way? It's easy to say, I want capitalism, but without the bad part. That's not a policy. That's a dream. You could say it's a nice dream. It's not a policy. You have to have an actual policy. When its actual consequences are in place, you have to decide what would actually happen then. So I'm going to close with one last example about bread, and I'm going to show you a video. Suppose we had a minister of bread. You are the minister of bread. It's up to you how much flour is going to be grown in the country, what kinds of bread are going to be produced, how much of each kind, when it will be available, what shape it'll be in. Who would you want to talk to understand what choices you should make as the minister of bread? What?
The bakers
and the consumers of Of bread, just the consumers of bread? We also have to take account the consumers of what? Pizza, right? Pasta, bagels. What about the gluten-free people? I assume it's fairly new. We have there's something here in Yerushalayim, glueless, right? It's gluten-free. Why are they doing that? They think there's an opportunity, right? But so if you were in charge and it wasn't left alone, you'd have to interview all those people. How long would that take? The rest of your life. Not only that, but what would you ask them? How much bread would you like? A lot. Doesn't it depend on what it costs in their answer to that question? So then you'd also have to do what? You have to pick the prices. Hard to do. It's hard to do. In many ways, what an economic system of freedom does is it takes the knowledge inside of our heads about what we like and don't like and mobilizes it to decide what gets produced. Now, some of the things that get produced, you might not like. Some people don't like the outcome of people's free choices. They think it's ugly, right? Too many TikToks, too many YouTube videos, too much fill in the blank. The things that you think, not enough Shakespeare, right? Not enough Plato, not enough Nietzsche, that's at Shalem, right? The higher things, the market's not so good at those, you would say. But actually, the truth is, you can still buy Plato. You can still read Aristotle. You can still read Nietzsche. You can still read Dante and Homer. The market does give you those things, but not as much as some of those other things, right? The shorter-term fun things. It gives people usually what they want. You may not like what people want. Of course, you like what you want, because what you want, that's different, right? What I want, that's good. But that's the challenge. The challenge is that market forces, competition and prices, when left alone, tends to give people what they want, and some people don't like those outcomes. They think it leads to too many poor people. We'll talk about that on Wednesday. It leads to too many things that are not high and attractive, but are less attractive, that appeals to the worst inside us, et cetera, right? The Kardashians. I know the name. I think there's somebody named Kim. Is that right? Is there a Kim Kardashian? It's almost impossible not to know. She is a great product of free market capitalism, right? The number of hours that people have spent paying attention to her life is enormous. And capitalism gives us that. Freedom gives us that. You could argue that time might be better spent doing something else. Reading to blind people, helping cats on the street, anything besides thinking about what Kim is wearing, right? But that's what people like. So you have to sometimes, you might decide to accept that and try other ways to get people to care about other things. Just as in the minimum wage, I think the right way to help people who are low skilled is something other than requiring them to earn a minimum amount. I don't think that's necessarily the best way. Okay, I want to stop. We're going to show a video now that I made a few years ago about bread. And then we'll take questions.
If you look down upon a city with the widest bird's eye view, you might wonder how it functions. Who takes care of me and you? Who makes sure there's food for vegans and for carnivores as well? It seems like there's a wizard who has cast a magic spell. Just think of one small part. Who makes sure there's so much bread? You want rye, you want ciabatta, or make it sourdough instead? A baguette or a croissant? It doesn't matter, don't you see? You get yours and she gets hers and I get mine. How can that be? One's buying a dozen bagels to grace an impromptu brunch. One's using food stamps for a simple loaf to make her children lunch. No matter the amount we require, no matter the choices we make, an army of workers has mobilized to fashion the bread we partake. The farmer who grows the wheat the miller who grinds the flour, the baker and all the others who work hour after hour. They're all on their own, each one making independent decisions. But somehow, their plans fit together with the greatest degree of precision. So there must be a czar of wheat and flour, of trucks and of bread and yeast to allocate and oversee and plan, at the very least, for the unexpected change. What if today's not like yesterday? It never is, though, is it? So who keeps chaos away? Because there's order all around us. Things look as if they're planned, like the supply of bread in a city, enough to match up with demand. And though flour is used for more than just bread, we never have to fight over where it goes and who gets what. So why do we sleep so well at night, knowing nobody's in charge? It looks like all is left to chance. Yet in New York or London, as well as Paris, France, no one's worried the shelves will be empty. We take supply for granted. But it's a marvel, it's a miracle. The world's somehow enchanted. Of course, the result's never perfect, but the system's organic, alive. Over time, fewer people go hungry, and more bread lovers thrive. And if you're allergic to gluten, there are sellers who work for you, too. Your choices expand, and what you demand is created and waiting for you. I have my tastes, and you have yours. We each have our own urges, yet somehow there's no conflict. A harmony emerges. Our dreams can fit together like a quilt that someone weaves us. But there isn't a weaver of dreams. Reality deceives us. And here's the crazy thing. If someone really were in charge to make sure that bread was plentiful, with the power to enlarge the supply of flour and yeast and of bakers and ovens too, would that person with that power have any idea of what to do? Could a minister of bread do even half as well? Would there be enough of every kind of bread upon the shelves? How could he know how much to make of each kind every day? There'd be shortages and surpluses and waste and much dismay. You might think the job is easy. If the top seller's rye, then for every variety, push production up that high. Then no one's disappointed. Bread eaters will rejoice when they see that every bakery is filled with so much choice. Bread eaters, yes, but help. The forgotten pizza lover cries, all the flour's gone to baking bread. There's none left for the pies of pepperoni, deep dish, thin crust, and Sicilian. You've solved the bread challenge, yes, but created another million problems. No problem. We'll just grow lots more wheat. But that means less of something else that people like to eat, which only makes the puzzle of the harmony around us much more puzzling. This order, this peace, has to astound us. So many things we count on, yet no one's behind the curtain. No wizard, no controls, yet the supply of stuff near certain. Every morning, the bakers rise early to make sure your bread is fresh. And the world gets more complicated, but the plans just continue to mesh. Every morning, the bakers rise early, though not under anyone's command. Where in the anatomy textbooks can I view an invisible hand? The key to the process is prices and the freedom to shop where you want. Competition among all the bakers. Make sure that they rise before dawn to make sure the bread's near perfection, to make sure that the buyer's content. You don't have to know economics to know when your money's well spent. We know there's order built into the fabric of the world of nature. Flocks of geese, schools of fish, and every boy and girl delights in how the stars shine down in all their constellations. And the planets stay on track and keep the most sublime relations with each other. Order's everywhere. Yet we humans too create it. It emerges. No one intends it. No one has to orchestrate it. It's the product of our actions, but no single mind's designed it. There's magic without wizards, if you just know how to find it.
Like you have said that in difficult questions, the government shouldn't make a choice. Like when it's too difficult and you have to consider too many things, so you say we don't know how to get the right decision, so the government just should let alone and leave this question. And my question is, what would you answer to someone that says that unless we live in anarchy, so the government always make decisions, and it do it like from the perspective of its, from some specific ideology, when it defines property or even the rules of the game and the boundaries of the rights.
Yep.
So we actually make decisions, like even when we are not able not to choose, because when we are not choosing, like actively, we are making choices.
Absolutely. So first, I want to just make a small change in what you said. I didn't mean to say that because it's complicated, the government shouldn't choose. I was saying when the government doesn't choose, sometimes things turn out very well. What I was emphasizing in this video is harmony, harmonia. The fact that we don't fight over things, which we don't think about because it just happens. But it doesn't mean that government chooses all the time. In the beginning, what I was trying to emphasize was that those choices are harder than they look, okay? So yes, government makes choices all the time, benefiting one group at the expense of the other. Is that good or bad? It depends on what you think about the value of those different groups. I think there's a much bigger philosophical picture, which I can't give you in an hour, about the virtue of dynamic, meaning the ability of the economy to emerge and evolve. I'm going to give you one short example, okay? In the United States, in the 1990s, we had a big debate in the early part of the 1990s of whether we should let goods come in from Mexico without a tariff, without a tax, import taxes. It was called NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement. How many people have heard of it? Okay, so that was the debate. Should cheap goods, cheaper, less expensive goods be allowed into the United States? There was a town in Illinois that made brooms, okay? A lot of the people in that town worked in a factory that made brooms. People in Mexico are much better at making brooms. In fact, nobody knew this at the time. I never saw it, but I later found out. A lot of the people who worked in that factory were Mexicans who had come from Mexico to work in Illinois, in a state in the United States. But that wasn't the way the story was told. The story was told this little town in Illinois is going to be destroyed if we allow in Mexican brooms. So I ask you, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Should we allow freedom? Should we allow Americans to be free to buy brooms from wherever they want, from Mexico, United States? And if they do, I know what's going to happen. There are going to be more brooms bought in Mexico, in the United States, and that town, the factory that makes the brooms, is going to close, and they're going to go out of business. And those workers will not have jobs. And again, what would have happened is they would have gone back to Mexico and made brooms in Mexico instead of in Illinois. But put that to the side. Is that a good thing? And an economist will often tell you, and I think this is the utilitarian argument, which I think is actually wrong, but it's a standard argument in economics. If you're an economics major, you've heard it before. Free trade is, economics majors, what's the word that comes next? Free trade is?
Efficient.
It's a more effective use of our resources. Because what's going to happen? We're going to have cheaper brooms. True. And what's going to happen if we have cheaper brooms? We'll have more money to spend on other things. And those things will grow. And some of the workers who worked in the broom factory, they'll work in those industries. But guess what? Some of them will not have the skills to do the new things. So the question would be, you might think, the question is it worth Americans saving a dollar or two on a broom, which would be nice, that's pleasant, and destroying a town? What would you do? Would you let the town be destroyed in the name of economic freedom? Most people would say no. Most people would say no. I think they're probably right. It's a terrible trade. I think it's not the trade, though. I don't think that's the question. But that's what looks like the question, right? What economics teaches you is that's not the only thing that happens. One of the greatest lines in economics, I've heard it attributed to Thomas Sowell or to George Stigler, who I think was Thomas Sowell's teacher. The most important question in economics is, and then what? What comes next? So in this case, what comes next, in my view, I'll give you a different example because I know this personally. In the United States, in the 1800s, in the northeastern part of the United States, in Massachusetts, there was an enormous industry making textiles, fabric, clothes. It was in two towns, Lowell and Lawrence, okay? Guess what happened? Competition came from South Carolina and North Carolina, and those plants closed. And as a result, all the workers in those factories were unemployed for a while, maybe a long time. And then guess what happened? Those factories in North Carolina and South Carolina closed. Guess why? Where did they open? China. Because Chinese were even cheaper than, so at first North Carolina was cheaper than Massachusetts, then China was cheaper than North Carolina. And because we let that happen, we could have stopped it anywhere. We could have stopped it from South Carolina. We could have said in the United States, even though it was American, we could have said, it's important to preserve these jobs. And we would have, as a result, been poorer. And of course, money's not all that matters. It's not. But it's not just about the money. Because we let that happen, the world changed, not just the fabric world, not just the clothing world. So one of the things we got because we let it happen is unbelievably inexpensive clothing, which is a lovely thing. Now, it's true that your closet has too many clothes in it, almost certainly, right? Am I right? Do you have too many clothes? Almost certainly. You could have a lot fewer. How many people have more than five pairs of shoes? Raise your hand. Right? Like, really? How many people have more than 10 pairs of shoes? Raise your hand. Oh, come on! You can only wear one at a time. Surely two or three would be plenty. But what the market gives you is lots of shoes. Why? They're relatively inexpensive. And you might say, well, that's not so important. But of course, it is important. Because it means that Chinese people who make those shoes and Indonesians who make those shoes have a real life now that they didn't have. So they actually, it's not just about a little more money for them. They went from near death, subsistence level, Ramat Chaim, to a decent life, a world where their children could actually go to school, a world where people could gain the skills to lead a fulfilling life. So it isn't just about the money, but when we let that system go, we do get cheaper stuff. And that's fine, it's nice, but that's not the reason to love it. We love it because it creates life, it creates vitality, it creates the opportunities that change the world. So Lowell and Lawrence, Massachusetts, which used to have these huge factories, they're empty now. They've been empty for 100 years. And I have a friend who teaches economics who grew up in that town. And his mother said to him, gee, it's a shame the factories are gone because they were good jobs. And you know what my friend said to her? He said, Mom, if we'd kept those factories here, I'd be working in them. I wouldn't be a professor. Why? Because there wouldn't be enough wealth to sustain the opportunity for people to be able to take off time to go to college. Going able to go to have a large portion of your population be college educated is an unbelievable change in human history. But it required giving up the textile mill in Lawrence, Massachusetts. Because if you don't do that, if you stop it there, yes, it'll be good for a while for those people. And that's, I understand the impulse. But that's not the only thing that happens. This whole then what changes too and creates this world, which is rich, not in money. It is rich in money, but more than money, in ideas and opportunities. How much time do you spend on Wikipedia, on YouTube, learning how to cook? How many people look at cooking videos on YouTube? I do, not so much, but our family does. It's an amazing thing. The wealth of understanding that's out there is extraordinary. You can't have that unless you allow people the freedom to allocate those resources where they go. So back to the brooms. If you let the Mexican brooms come in, it will be hard for the people in that town. But if you stop everything in trade, you lead a much smaller life, a much more constricted life with less freedom, less opportunity, less choice. Not just choice about what to buy, yes, that's true here in Israel, right? Our choices of what to buy are limited because of government policy with respect to trade. But that's not the most important part of it. The most important part of it is what comes after that if we let it go. Okay, long answer, sorry. Yeah.
Regarding the situation in Israel.
Yeah.
When you talk about brooms or clothes, it's okay, but there is an argument in Israel that says, okay, the food here is expensive because we have to preserve the local industry,
right,
in order to not be in a situation where we cannot supply food for the people.
Of course.
Because of external reasons,
sure,
such as boycott of any sort,
yep,
war. So does this argument hold water? And if so, how do you see it in this harmony that was shown in the short video?
Can I use that? Thank you. It does hold water. Okay, there we go. Okay, a little water, not so much. It's not irrelevant. It's relevant. By the way, here's the best part of this. They make the same argument. The farmers in the United States make the same argument. We have 350 million people. We have 100 times the land area, 1,000, I don't know what it is, 50, 100 times the land space of Israel. But of course, if we don't grow our own wheat, we could be at the risk of the Russians, Chinese. What if we go to war? It's not irrelevant. It's ridiculous in the United States. It's absurd. Same arguments were made for why we have to have our own cars. You know why we have to protect the American auto industry? National defense. What if we're in a war? We don't have any cars. Guess what? We won't be able to make what? Tanks. Actually, hear this argument. You know what my answer is? First of all, in America, tanks not so important. We could fight lots of good wars without any tanks. Number two, you don't think we could figure out how to make tanks? If we didn't have a car industry, we don't have enough smart people. We don't have enough engineers. An incredible thing, by the way, when we thought in America that ventilators, the breathing devices in the hospital, were going to be in a shortage, car makers started making ventilators. I'm thinking, well, thank goodness we protected the car makers. We can have ventilators. No, I was thinking, people can do creative things under great crises. So could Israel be at risk of starvation? Starvation because of foreign policy? It's possible, right? If Israel had no friends, right? If the United States turned against Israel completely, which it could, right? 25 years ago, I would have said that's ridiculous. But now it's not so ridiculous. Maybe Israel and the United States will not be friends in 10 years. We're sort of friends now. We used to be pretty good friends. Now we're sort of friends. Maybe it'll be not friends, enemies even. Will there be no country friendly to Israel? By the way, if that's true, the wheat supply will not be our biggest problem, okay? But it's not irrelevant, right? You could argue that it has some value. It's a little harder to make the argument for honey. I think there's 5 honey producers in Israel and they don't let anyone else make honey. And they're in charge of who should make honey. Is that a good idea? No, probably not. In America, we have the same bad law. If you want to open a hospital in America, you have to get permission for the existing hospitals. Guess what they always say? I think we have plenty. It's not in every state. It's about 30-something states have this regulation.
We have this new clause in our Chok Hesdelim.
In what?
The new Chok Hesdelim.
What's that?
The Chok Hesdelim, the law that goes with the budget and does all the regulation. So we now have the same law in the upcoming...
For hospitals?
Yeah. Every hospital, new clinic, the hospital is 40 kilometers around it, need to agree.
Okay, because the argument would be, what would the argument be for that? Well, they know how the market is, they know what the demand is, right? Which is true, but their incentives are not so good for, okay. There's a question over here?
Yeah.
No, did you have a question?
Yeah, it was kind of related to what
he
was asking.
Okay, other question?
Yes, please. So you showed at your video an appearance of harmony.
Appearance of harmony, correct.
Yes. But the thing is that in our world, we know that about a third of the food is being thrown away.
A third of the food is being thrown away?
Or even getting destroyed to keep the prices where they stand.
I don't think that's the reason. I don't think the food is... Let me back up. The video is a little bit romantic about the bread market, certainly. At the end of the day, there is bread left over, actually. So I talked about the fact that there isn't a shortage. But in a certain dimension, the system produces a surplus every day. So I didn't give you the quote. One of my favorite quotes is from a former colleague of mine, Walter Williams. He said, "When I go to the grocery, I don't tell them I'm coming. I don't tell them what I'm going to buy, and I don't tell them how much I'm going to buy. But if they don't have it waiting for me, I fire them." Right? If you go to a grocery and every day that doesn't have the food you want, you don't go there anymore. Right? So in the real world, actually what happens is that the baker produces more bread than is likely to be needed at the end of the day. So the system, you could say, is actually wasteful. Now, at the end of the day, they try to do things with it. My son has been volunteering this summer. One of our children is here with us for the summer, and he works in Matsilot Mazond. Is that what it's called? What is it?
Hatzalat
Mazon. And he was on TV. It was on Channel 11. It's very exciting. He's a much better accent than I do, and his hand gestures were excellent, I thought. So there are organizations that Leket also does this. They collect food that's left over. But the question would be, why do they? I mean, it's a very complicated question, actually, because I pay a high, even though I think bread, I don't know, in Israel, I don't know if it's cheap, but in America, bread's very inexpensive and very high quality. And I pay a premium, even though it's inexpensive, it's more expensive than it could be because they want to make sure there's enough bread at the end of the day that no one shows up and says, "I'm here," and, "Oh, we're out," right? They're never out. So they actually make too much, I put that in quotes, because they can't forecast the demand. If they said the only way you can buy bread is by ordering it in advance, there'd be no waste. But that's not the world I want to live in. It's not the world you want to live in. Anybody ever see the movie The Truman Show with Jim Carrey? It's one of my favorite movies. It's about a man who has nothing new in his life. Every day does the same thing over and over and over again. And there's a mastermind, a genius. His name is Christos, which is not a coincidence, that's his name. It's supposed to be evoking a godlike person who's running his life and he doesn't know it. And they anticipate everything he's going to do so that the bread's always waiting for him, the newspaper always waits for him. And it's a totally artificial world. And then one day, the character, it's the first 10 minutes of the movie, does something unexpected. And it's chaos. And right, part of what my video is showing is that we all do that all the time. I can change. I can not get bread today. I get a different kind of bread. I can get gluten-free if I want today. I can get rye bread. I could get a bagel instead of a loaf. We do that all the time. We take it for granted. But in the movie, when he says, "Oh, I want something different," it's like, oh my gosh, people are constantly running around trying to figure out what he's going to do next. Because he has to be deceived into thinking he has a real life. And why did I bring that up? What was I talking about? Oh, the leftover food, right? So in the real world, since you don't know what people are going to do, the bakers and the produce people and the fruit and vegetable people and the chicken people make extra. And it actually, we have to pay for that. You don't see it, but we pay a premium because that's what we want. Our time is extremely valuable, right? So we never want to show up and say, "Oh, come back tomorrow." So there's extra. Now, we try to do things with it, Hatzalot Mazon and Leket and others, but there is some waste, for sure. And that waste is, this is so great. Why is there waste? Because we're trying to save something that's more precious than bread. What is that?
Time.
A fixed amount of it. I don't want to spend all my time shopping. I want to free up time for other things. So there is waste, but that's because real life has uncertainty, and to account for that uncertainty, they make extra. to save us time, something that we have decided is more precious. Why do I say we have decided it's more precious? Because if we didn't agree, what could happen? Someone could open a store that sometimes they were out, but it was very inexpensive. And you could shop there. But people don't shop at those stores. They want to be at the store where it's always there for them because their time is very precious. That's for us. That's what's so amazing about it. I think we're out of time. Should we stop, Bob? One more question? We did take, he did show that other video. I have at least 5 more minutes. Go ahead.
So you talked before about minimum wage.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, would you propose canceling minimum wage in Israel?
Yeah.
To be zero?
Yeah, and in America, anywhere. I think it's a bad policy. I think it's an excuse for governments that have provided horrible education. So if you provide horrible education, you're going to have a lot of people who don't have any skills and are going to have trouble finding work, okay? So instead of fixing the education system, we have this artificial way of helping them by giving them, not by giving them, by forcing employers to pay more than they otherwise would. I just have to say this, it's kind of important. Usually, not always, but almost always, the wages that people earn are not set by the people who pay the money. It looks that way. I've spent all my life working in universities. Almost all my life. I've done some other work. I worked at a racetrack. I worked in a retail store. I worked at Howard Johnson's, which means nothing to you. But I know Bob will appreciate that. Hojo's. But most of my life I worked at a university. Do I have a high salary or a low salary compared to, say, Wall Street, where I've never worked? Which pays more, Wall Street, finance, or universities? How can that be? Universities are nicer, aren't they? They're amuta, right? They're not for profit. Well, shouldn't they pay their workers more? Why do they pay so little? Why do I make such, this is kind of a joke. It's like a fake thing, right? Actually, professors now make a reasonably large amount of money compared to what they used to make. But they still make less than they make on Wall Street, right? But you'd think Wall Street, they're greedy on Wall Street. The salaries must be really low. No, they're not. Why? Why are they high on Wall Street? It's not because they're nice. It's because the skills that they want to hire are what? Scarce, rare, right? They like to hire people who are really good at physics and mathematics and numbers. There aren't a lot of those people. There's not enough to go around. So they pay a premium to attract them. People who like to teach, what the Talmud calls a sweet-smelling job, right? A fun job, a pleasant job. There are a lot of people who want to do that. So we don't make as much money as we would otherwise. It has nothing to do with how loving or kind or selfless or caring the employer is. Now, there's some exceptions to that, but in general, it's true. The wages are not set by the person who's writing the check. They're set by a whole other set of wider forces. The wages emerge. They're not set. They come from the market, the interactions of lots of people, not just you and your boss. Another, one more question, maybe? Yes, Bob.
So in that context, you know, I always say to students when they apply to the program that the reason we want more understanding of economic freedom in this country is that we have a situation, among the reasons, is that students graduate here at universities, they have the same skills as counterparts in the United States, and then they see that these individuals in the United States are making more money than they are.
Yeah.
So could you address that?
Well, you know, it's, you make your two biggest choices in life are your spouse and your parents. The third choice is, there's two more that are important. Where you're born and what year, right? If you were born in Poland in 1910, you might not be here today, all right? And if you were born in Poland in 1910 and you were here and you stayed there and you weren't Jewish, you're still going to be living in Poland. Not the easiest thing in the world, right? My joke on my, I have a podcast, Econ Talk. How many people listen to it? Raise your hand. It's just terrible. Three people? Four? Seriously, check it out. There's only 800 episodes now. They're all free. They're all available online. Econ Talk, one word. But my joke on Econ Talk is the way you solve poverty, and I think Omer is going to be talking about this, the way you solve poverty is simple in a lot of the world. You just need luggage. You need suitcases. You need people to move, get out of the place where they are, where there's no opportunity, to a place where there is opportunity. And you, if you were in Mexico and you walk 1 foot across the border into the United States, all of a sudden you're more productive. You have a higher wage. How is that? What the heck? How is it? How is that? That's crazy. But it's almost as crazy, we don't think about it, that if you're born today in 2020, 21, and you don't have many skills, you make an unbelievably better living if you have a job. You make an and most people do. You have an unbelievably better standard of living than a person born in 1500. You're not any smarter. You're not smarter at all, say. You don't have any more education, but you make a better job just with your hands in 2021 than you do in 1521. Why? What changed? I don't know if you're going to talk about that, Omer, but that's a miracle. That's crazy. It's not because people are nicer and paying higher wages. The world has changed. We have more opportunity in Iraq. We have economic freedom. Think about China and India. It's an unbelievable story. People were living on a dollar a day. Now they're living on $5 a day, a lot of it. It's not great, but it's better than a dollar, a lot better. And the children will live a better life. So transformation requires a whole set of things. It requires the freedom to interact with lots of people. We were talking last night, I'll finish with this. You can take the 50 most talented people in the world. You can pick them. You'll be one of the 50. You pick the other 49. You can pick whoever you want. And you're going to go live on an island, and you can have whatever you want on the island. You can have oil. You can have gold. You can have copper. You can have anything you want, titanium. And you can have the 49 most talented people in the world with you, and you will be desperately poor. You will never achieve anything remotely like the standard of living we have in any modern Western country and in many Eastern countries now over the last 20 years. Why? Because we have figured out the opportunity and created opportunity for us to work not with 50 people, but 50 million, 500 million. And when you trade with lots of people, you become, the opportunity comes for specialization and the application of capital and the application of technology. 50 people can't use technology. You're not going to build a car. It's not because you don't have far to drive. It's because you literally, if that's what you did, you would spend all your time on cars and you would starve to death because you couldn't provide enough food to feed yourself. But when you have a billion and 5 billion people, if they trade, they can all get a higher standard of living. So the reason that you have a higher standard of living in the United States than you have in Israel, there's a lot of reasons. But one of the reasons is that in Israel, you trade with fewer people, not just within your borders, but outside your borders, and there are limitations that have been put in place. Don't move to the United States, though. We need you here. He said, he's been here 6 weeks. He's already talking like a nationalist. Okay. Thank you, folks.